Amen. We wanted to start this evening with a little bit of a patriotic song there with the choir. But we're going to take our hymn books. We're going to go to hymn number 67. Do want to welcome you to tonight's service. Thank you for being back in the house of the Lord. We've got a number of people sick, a number of people out, and so some are even out of town. But keep all different folks in prayer. But let's go ahead and we'll enjoy being in the house of the Lord tonight. Let's turn to hymn 67, The Love of God, beautiful song. Let's all stand and open up with this hymn, The Love of God, hymn 67 this evening. On the first,
the love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty man second verse, when years of time shall pass away and earthly thrones and kingdoms fall, when men who hear refuse to pray on rocks and hills and mountains call, God's love so sure shall still endure all measureless and strong. Grace to Adam's race, the saints and angels.
On the chorus,
oh love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels' song.
Now here's what I like, that third verse, probably one of the most beautiful verses I've ever seen in the history of songwriting. When you look at it, could we with ink the oceans fill, were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole though stretched from sky to sky. Boy, what a beautiful thought concerning the love of God and just how vast it is. We could not fill the sky. The ocean could not contain enough ink, and there wouldn't be enough men to write it down to really fully describe the love of God. What a beautiful thought. Let's sing that third verse together with the chorus.
Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole though stretched from sky to sky. Oh love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels' song.
Amen. Again, glad to see everybody this evening. Looking forward to, be honest with you, in all honesty, I'm not really looking forward to preaching what we have for tonight. Because it's another one of those things that, as I said this morning, once you preach it, once you teach it, you have to then, one way or another, you get the opportunity to try to live it. And we are actually going to split tonight's message into two different services. So we're going to start it tonight, and we'll pick it back up next Sunday night, dealing with patience. I know you're thinking, boy, if one night's not bad enough, you're going to put two nights on it. That's just because I want to be patient with it, all right? And we're gonna all learn patience as we look through that. But we'll get there in just a little bit. And it's just good to be back again in the house of the Lord. And I think it rained again this afternoon. I don't know. My face was buried in a laptop for a while, and then my eyes were shut after that, and I don't remember what happened. But it was a decent afternoon, and I'm just glad to be back here, looking forward to what the Lord has for us. Brother Sonny Misseldine, would you open us up in prayer?
Lord, it's so wonderful to be in your house. The love of God, you loved us before we were, and the love is so tremendous, and you gave your Son, and what you provided for us. Did not deserve it. And thank you for what you do for me in my life. And I pray that you'll bless this service and use this as we need and touch our hearts. And use it.
Amen. You can be seated. Let me just give you those simple reminders, which again, if you did not get a bulletin from this morning, be sure to grab one in the foyer before you leave. It has the main pertinent information that's right around the corner and then a few upcoming events as well, and kind of keep that calendar rolling for you. But don't forget that July the 15th will be our official deacons meeting for the month of July, and then that following Wednesday will be our official church business meeting, which will actually be our not just our main church business meeting, but it will be our pretty much the annual business meeting to a degree. We'll be dealing with a lot of stuff that is normally taken care of in the month of July, so as to get things rolling for August and things going there. So just keep that in mind in the next week or so at what's coming up. Then July 19th, Six Flags for the teenagers. We'll be leaving at 5:30 in the morning, and I will sleep as Brother Butch drives. And at least I think I will. I don't know. He'll probably, hey, preacher, I need to talk about something. And get me up there. Next thing you know, we'll be talking the whole way. But typically, my problem is waking up is always a difficult thing. But once I've gotten woke up, even if I wanted to go to sleep, I couldn't get back to sleep if I tried. And which is why I'd just rather be left alone, because once you wake me up, I'm finished. And and there ain't no getting more sleep. So, but seeing that I'm going to have to probably drive over or walk over, I'll be awake. So, and I won't get to go back to sleep. But we are looking forward to that July 19th Six Flags trip with the young people. And just pray we don't kill any of them on the way there or back. But then July 20th, if you can, it's kind of a mixture of things day. We will be from at 10 o'clock in the morning on that Saturday, July 20th. We'll be up here. Anybody that can come and help us to set things up for VBS, we would greatly appreciate the help in the decorating the platform. We got to move the chairs, got a whole bunch of stuff to get everything set up. Oh, by the way, with that, as you would guess, that Sunday, the 21st, we won't have choir, okay? Because there'll be nowhere for us to go unless, of course, we trampled all over our campground. And so we're not going to do that. But that'll be an interesting Sunday morning. We will be the most modern church that you have ever seen in your life. I mean, we will be completely changed. People walk in and say, why is there, you know, the platform is a campground. Well, we're just trying to be all things to all men. All right. But no, I had a friend of mine recently. We were doing something. No, it was for the wedding. We had everything moved up here. We had the whole drapery and all that kind of stuff right behind. And he watched on a live stream one of our services. He said, I'm so glad to see you're stepping up into the modern age of how things look in auditoriums nowadays. And I said, yeah, shut up. But but he was giving me a hard time about our decorations on the platform. Just wait until he sees on the 21st. But we will, if you can come and help us on the 20th, that Saturday morning. And then at 4 o'clock, we plan on being out at Sparkman Park there under the pavilion, which we have reserved for us the whole day. And so even if we need to send some fellas there prior to 4 o'clock to start the fish frying and getting things ready, that'll be available to us at any point that we want to get out there on that day. So if we finish up here early, we get things done, and people want to go out there and just go ahead and get to the park and have some fun out there together, then that'll be available as well. But our goal is to go out on the 20th there, once we're done here, and by 4 o'clock be at the park having our church fish fry. And so you are more than welcome. Everybody's welcome to come and enjoy that. Now, there is a sign-up sheet. I can't remember if I said that this morning or not, but there is a sign-up sheet in the foyer as to what you, if you're coming, what it is that you might be bringing as some side dishes or anything extra that you might want to bring. I mean, fish are good, but they're always better with something on the side with them as well. And so if you want to fix a dessert or some kind of dish to bring out there to go with the fish fry, then please put down what it is that you're bringing so we can keep track of who all plans to come and what they're bringing with them. But that will be, again, just remember that that is on the 20th at 4 o'clock. That's going to be our fish fry out there at Sparkman Park. And so you come and help us in the morning time, and then we'll all go eat and fellowship in the afternoon and have a good time there. And let some other folks that maybe didn't make it the day or not here, just try to let folks know. We'll probably put it on Facebook as well, just to let the church family know that that's our appointed time for the fish fry, all right? And I will say this, if you have somebody that you know would like to have some fellowship and doesn't get around much, maybe they... it's a friend of yours, and they don't really do much with their church or whatever. If you'd like to bring them as your guest, I would say you bring them as well as your guest, and we'll fellowship with them. We're not looking to have 200-300 people out there, but well, we are looking to be open for folks to bring a friend if they have somebody that could use the fellowship. All right. So with that, I'm going to set that aside and. We're going to move on this evening. The choir is going to sing for you. It's a familiar song and called Come and Dine. And so we're going to sing that, a little bit of a peppy arrangement, you might say. It just it's one of those songs where you can sing one way or the other. But I told the choir, we're going to sing it cheerfully. All right. They said, well, preacher, if you'll just kind of jig as you're leading it, we'll all have fun. Like, yeah, I don't want to entertain quite that much, but we're going to enjoy this song. Hopefully you enjoy it as well. The Lord does bid unto us. Hey, come and dine. It's open and free for everybody to be a part of. So listen to the song. Let it be a blessing to you.
Come and dine with this man, he doth lead us to lies our every day.
I'm thankful that the Lord allows us to come to the table and dine. Amen. We don't deserve to be there, but it's kind of like Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth didn't deserve, he wasn't part of the king's family. He was part of the previous king's family. And yet David, because of his love for Jonathan, said, I want to do good to somebody in the family line of Saul for Jonathan's sake. Found Mephibosheth and said, hey, you're now going to eat at my table from now on as one of the king's sons. Basically, he looked at Mephibosheth and said, hey, come and dine. Why don't you come and enjoy it? You don't necessarily have the right to be here other than the fact that I have proclaimed you have the right. It's not natural. It is freely given. And boy, what a wonderful thing it is to know that somebody so unworthy has an opportunity to be requested by the King of Kings to come and dine at his table. Boy, what a wonderful, wonderful thought. Why don't you take your hymn books one more time. Let's go to hymn 45. Hymn 45, let's all stand. Let's sing Surely Goodness and Mercy. It's a very good chorus, but it has some verses to it. Beautiful song. Let's sing this together. On the first.
A pilgrim was I and a wandering. In the cold night of sin I did roam. Then Jesus the kind shepherd found me. And now I am on my way home. Surely and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Let's sing that second verse.
He restoreth my soul when I'm weary. Giveth me strength day by day. He leads me beside the still waters. He guards me each step of the way. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely shall follow me all the days of my life.
Choir's coming down. Why don't y'all find somebody next to you, shake their hand, smile at them, tell them you're happy to see them tonight. We find our way back to our seat. We're going to sing that last verse. We get ready to receive our offering. We are going to do that last little final refrain there at the very end. So get ready for that, and we'll finish off strong with this song. Let's sing that third verse, hymn 45.
when walk through the dark, lonesome valley, my Savior will walk with me there, and safely his great hand will lead me to the mansion he's gone to prepare. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Here we go. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I shall feast at the table spread for me.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Days. I forgot that part.
My.
See, now they know how it goes. My dad never ended with that last little tag. He always ended. I tell you what, this book keeps messing me up. I tell you. They change words on me. They change the songs on me. They completely omit songs. I was joking with somebody a while back saying, I'll tell you, okay, this is not the King James Version of the hymn book. No. I'm picking. But, definitely, it's still a good song. I'm glad y'all know how it went. Amen. If we let one of them lead it, we'd be okay. But again, this is our time to give back to the Lord as He's given to us. And Amy Carmichael made a statement, and once again, one of those individuals who has through history been an example of serving the Lord. But here's what she said. Basically, she said, "This much I will say. With every fresh need has come a fresh supply." And it's very true. There's not a single need that we face. We talked about it this morning. Not a single need that we face that God hasn't already got the answer. His answer and his supply is 100% sufficient. It never lacks. And put it this way, even though he may not be in my time, he's never late. He always knows when, how, where, and just how much that he needs to provide for my life. And my opportunity to give back to him is merely just one little way that I can show him how much I love him and how faithful I desire to be in giving back to him what already belongs to him in the first place. Well, let's continue to be faithful. It is through the faithful giving of God's people. As we talked about this morning, Jesus himself was willing, even though he didn't have to, he was willing to give so as not to be an offense or not to give the idea to anybody watching that they didn't have to be a part of giving. He wanted to always set the example, and that should be our heart as well. That's where it comes into the offering side of things. Not my tithe, but sometimes Lord gives me an opportunity just to give a little above and beyond. Gives me an opportunity to be a part of missions. Is that actually a command? Not necessarily. God doesn't command that I give money to send missionaries around the world, but he does command that we get the gospel around the world. So when he lays on my heart that I can be a part of getting the gospel around the world, why would I not want to be a part of Faith Promise Missions? All those little things. I'm preaching a whole other message. Y'all don't need all that. All right? But let's just continue to be faithful, so God can use us to do a great work in the time that we have left here at Bethel Baptist Church in this wonderful free country that we enjoy. Well, let's ask a blessing on the offering, and we'll receive that. Brother Bryant, if you would pray for us. Amen. just before the preaching, which, of course, you know where we're headed. We're headed back to 2 Peter chapter 1. But just before that, Miss Wanda is going to sing our special for us.
To die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away your stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl, and remember when you walk, sometimes you fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes your way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark, pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Oh, and when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then shout to Jesus, shout to Jesus, shout to Jesus and live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss this old world goodbye and go in peace and laugh on heaven's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus.
Thank you, Miss Wanda. There's no place we can go that's any greater than our Savior. What a beautiful song. Well, let's take our Bibles, and if you're already there, 2 Peter chapter 1. We just read. By the time we get done with all this, you're going to have this passage of Scripture right here committed to memory, which would not be a bad thing. But we're looking here, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 5 through verse number 7. Beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith. And we started off with adding to that foundation of faith, virtue. And to virtue, we dealt with knowledge. And to knowledge, last week we dealt with temperance. And tonight we're on the end of temperance, patience. And it says, into patience, godliness, into godliness, brotherly kindness, and a brotherly kindness, charity. Once again, we are building our pathway to charity, a love like the Father. And the love of the Father, to love Him the way we should, and to love the love of the Father in the way we should love others like He would love them. And the only way we get to that charity, only way we get to that ultimate goal, is we have to go through the steps that we have been given here, laid out before us. You must start off with faith. Without the foundation of faith, you have nothing to build on. But once you have a foundation of faith, and again, let me just remind you, it doesn't take anything more than a mustard seed of faith to start with. Doesn't have to be a mountain's worth. Doesn't have to be this unbelievable, high spiritual experience of faith. All it needs to be is a mustard seed. Just enough to plant into your life to set the foundation of that things can grow on. And so as that seed is planted, it can grow and become a very strong foundation in your life. And that faith can then give you something to build on, such as virtue, which we dealt with, being just the ability to obey, a purity about obedience in just following the Lord. When our virtue shows forth, we are a reflection of who Christ really is. And then to virtue knowledge, once we have the right heart, once we are pure, then that knowledge is going to be of the right things. It's going to be knowledge of God, all about Him, about what He wants, about who He is, how we can please Him. That knowledge is going to increase in us that focus of virtue, which is going to then build even greater in our life a purity upon the faith we have in God. And then as you add that knowledge to it, then you come to an opportunity that once knowledge is there, we need then learn how to temper ourselves. That one's tough. In all honesty, that one's tough. You say, I think I got control of it. Let something go haywire on you when you don't have time to deal with that. It's just, listen, I've had plenty of times where things have gone haywire and I'm cool as a cucumber. No big deal. I'm okay. Why? Because I'm not pressured. I'm not pushed. It's not that it's really got me worked up. And so, you know, I do really good those time frames. No problem. I got this conquered. And then the Lord brings something along my way to remind me just how little I know about temperance. He brings something at the one moment I don't have time for it. At the one time when I really have got to, this has got to come together, and it doesn't. Matter of fact, it just blows apart. And this is the wrong time. You ever notice that when things go bad, it's never a good time? And so that just seems to be one of the biggest struggles in our flesh is when things go haywire on us. When it really matters to you, that's when temperance is going to have its challenge. And so that temperance, though, allows us to understand a controlling factor, an ability to put ourselves under the control of the Holy Spirit. And as we become controlled properly by the Holy Spirit, and we place ourselves under His authority, through that, we grow in greater knowledge. And as we grow even in greater knowledge, we learn more about purity and how to live a godly life. And that is built upon that foundation even stronger. Our faith in God grows because of each of these things. Now you'll notice as we're going through, and the reason I come through it again and then I back it up back to faith and come through it again and back it back up to faith is because you don't conquer these things like check marks on a page. You can learn about virtue, and as you go on to knowledge, if you're not careful, you'll gain proper knowledge and forget about what it takes to maintain the right virtue. Or you can have virtue and knowledge, and before you know it, though you're focused on temperance, and you're so focused on getting victory in that area, you let virtue and knowledge kind of go by the wayside, and they begin to weaken, and your faith weakens a little bit. But I'm focused on this one. The thing is, while growing in the Lord, we also have to maintain where we've already come to. We can't let go. It's like, well, we were talking about this little courtyard out here. Okay, we're dealing with all that. We got to do some cleanup. We got to straighten some things up in there. Make it look pretty again. Why? Because we can, let me just put this, we're working on building issues inside. And as we're increasing, building things inside, as we're improving things on the inside, if we don't keep maintaining what's already been done, though we might do great here, you turn around and over here, just it's like, what happened? That thing went to ruin again. Because though we conquered that area for the moment, if it doesn't have a level of maintenance in our life over virtue and maintenance over knowledge and maintenance in our temperance, as we grow, we're trying to conquer these new areas of education and growth in our Christian walk, but we cannot forget to maintain what we've already learned. And so therefore, it's a constant back and forth. We have to scan. We have to constantly revisit those things that we have learned, because it is an ever-growing, ever-maintaining process in this Christian walk. And so as we are now coming to the next area that we can add to our faith, we're reaching the point now where we're going to be talking about patience. And yes, we're going to split this up between this Sunday and next Sunday night. I'm gonna do two different time frames with this, because I don't want to rush. I want to be patient with it. I don't want to rush through this and miss some things that probably we need to focus in on. So as we're looking at patience, just understand one area of growth does not negate the necessity of maintaining other areas that we've already passed. We have to constantly watch all of them. So let me as we were looking at this, I'm going to pray, and then we're gonna go over to a couple other passages of Scripture, and we're going to look at some of these things dealing with patience. And what does patience really mean? The definition in today's mentality in the world, even in our mentality, might be a little off from its actual meaning and description. So we'll look at that starting here in just a few minutes. Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for allowing us to be in your house. I pray that you would, Lord, give us exactly what we need tonight. I pray that you would teach us, educate us a little bit from your word concerning this area of patience. It is not the easiest thing, probably one of the most difficult things for us as human beings to truly learn how to be patient according to your word. But I pray that you'd help us to learn a little bit more, gather a little bit more of the information we need that we might grow to be more like you. And I pray that, Lord, you would strengthen our hearts and our minds to receive what we're looking at tonight, that we might please you in the days to come as we serve you. We ask it all in Christ's name. Amen. So as we're looking at this, let me just lay a little bit out here to you. Unfortunately, it's very sad, but today we live in a day and age when our culture has continually redefined words. And what things used to mean have now been completely laid out in a whole different aspect. Let me just put it this way. People aren't just trying to change the Bible so it fits a new description of what we want it to say, or it fits a new description of what we want to make sure it doesn't say. They're not just going after God's word. They're going after everyday words, everyday language and knowledge of what it takes to live a life that is right. Not just, and again, set aside God's word for a second. Let's just look from the world's perspective. Let's not use the Bible. Let's just use common sense education. All right? They have taken words and taken things that used to be, and I'll grant you, it came from biblical precepts, and I understand that used to be a little bit more of a factor in every single family. In one way or another, God's word affected, and the principles of God's word affected the mentality of people, especially in the United States. But if you set aside reading that book on a daily basis and growing to know what God has to say, let's just take into account that there are people that have no idea whatsoever what the Bible has to say about certain things. It used to be that society just had a standard moral code. And even somebody that did not go to church, or somebody that did not read the Bible, somebody that didn't claim to be a Christian, even those individuals in the not too distant past, actually had a sense of right and wrong, just what would be considered common sense. What would be considered just a natural way that things ought to be in society. And there were words that used to be pretty serious. Such as this. We used to say that when somebody told a bold-faced lie, that was the individual that you really couldn't trust. That was wrong to just outright lie to somebody. And just do it knowing what you're doing and knowing that people are going to figure it out, but you're just going to lie anyway. That bold-faced lie, that used to be a major thing. Now it's been redefined as, well, just misspeaking. They just misspoke. No, they didn't misspeak. Bold-faced lie means they purposely said what they wanted to say, and it was a lie. But now we've redefined it as, they made a mistake. They just said the wrong thing. They didn't really mean it. So we water that down. How about this? People used to understand what adultery was. Now adultery has been redefined as that's a little error in judgment. They made a small error in judgment on that one. Yeah, they probably shouldn't have done that, you think? But again, it's making sure we don't want things to sound too bad. We just need to ease it a little bit. How about this? Tolerance. Tolerance has now been defined as positive agreement to differences. So, in our society now, you're called intolerant if for some reason you can't find a way to positively agree to somebody else's differences. Well, why can't you just agree that they just think different than you? Well, I'll agree to that. I'm still going to say it's wrong. Well, that's not very tolerant. Well, God's word is very intolerant, if that's the definition of it. I'll just be honest with you. God's word is very intolerant of me half the time, much less dealing with what is absolute sin. No, there is no tolerance for sin. In God's word, God has no tolerance. Matter of fact, there's a whole reason why Christ had to die on the cross, because there was no give. It was no, well, that's not that bad. Listen, oh, by the way, just to throw this out there, the world lays out that there are degrees of wickedness. There's degrees of sin. You know, my sin's not as bad as theirs. You know, it's not like I have committed adultery. Oh, that's awful. You know, I just stole something. But then there are those that say, well, that stealing's horrible. I don't steal. Do you always tell the truth? Well, no, every now and then I fib a little bit. That's not that bad, though. No, that's not a big deal. At least I haven't murdered nobody. We have degrees of what we think is wrong and what's okay. See, we have allowed ourselves even, and society especially has influenced us, but we've allowed ourselves to put a hierarchy of what is, you know, not so bad to what is really bad. And God defines it as one word. Sin. Period. It's sin. Matter of fact, I'll just be honest with you. The sin of gossip is enough to keep you out of heaven, just like the sin of murder. The sin of a wrong thought is just as wicked in the areas of how God sees things. It is enough, just to have one wrong thought is enough to keep me from ever dwelling with God for all eternity without the forgiveness of sin. Just one bad thought. Well, but that wasn't that horrible. It's not like I did this or not like I did that. I'm not as bad as that person. God said that I'm not looking at the evidence of how bad you think you are versus somebody else. They that compare themselves among themselves are not wise. The Bible just simply lays out very just across the board, sin is sin. And whether we consider it to be a major sin or a minor sin, God says it's just sin. See, we have allowed ourselves to agree with the world to a degree, to agree with them that we can redefine things to feel a little bit better about where I am. I'm going to skip the rest of these that I have laid out here, different definitions of stuff. But when you get to even patience, we've redefined what patience is. We have a misconception of what it is based off of what we have deemed it to be, this or that. We've kind of given its own definition. We're going to look at the Bible definition between tonight and next Sunday. But here's what we think. And you tell me if I'm wrong, but this is the general concept concerning patience. Patience is just gritting our teeth and bearing it till it's over. Patience is just waiting it out. Just, if you just hold on long enough, just be patient, you'll survive. To a degree, that's the way we look at patience. Patience is that thing nobody wants to have to go through. And rightfully so, to a degree. But everybody says, hey, don't pray for patience because tribulation worketh patience. You don't want trouble. You just have to grit down and bear it. We see patience as merely just that. Just holding on long enough until it's finally over. But that's just a fraction of what patience really is and what it involves. Patience goes far beyond just grit and bear it. Patience actually, biblically, goes to the degree that many of us would consider, and definitely the world consider, to be completely ridiculous. James chapter 1, in verse 2 through verse number 4. Why don't you take your Bibles and go there with me very, very quickly. You're right near it already. Just a few pages over. But James chapter 1, verse 2 through verse number 4. Lays out a little bit of what patience is. And then I'm going to give you the definition out of Webster's 1828 dictionary. And give you a couple of things here and we'll wrap it up for tonight. But listen to what James tells the folks here in the New Testament, what we get to read and honestly would help us. In verse number, starting in verse number 2, it says, my brethren, he's writing to family, he's writing to the children of God. My brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, her completion, her completing elements. Let patience be completed in you. Have a perfect work that ye may be perfect, not sinless. That word perfect deals with the idea of complete. If you want to be complete as a child of God, you've got to let patience have its complete, perfect work. That ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Now, if you go back to verse number 2, the basis of patience is in the beginning of verse number 2. My brethren, count it all joy. What? Joy? You realize it's about to talk about temptations and troubles and trials and problems? Yeah, it's teaching us what the Lord uses as instruments to instruct us in what real patience is all about. But he says, count it all joy. Don't just grit and bear it. Just hold on a little bit longer. That's not what he's saying. He's saying, learn how to count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. When God chooses to place things in your life to teach you valuable lessons, especially in this work of patience in our lives, He's teaching us how to trust. He's teaching us where to, as the song said just a minute ago, where to rest. If you're going to fall, fall on Jesus. If you're going to struggle, struggle on His shoulders. If you got to cry, go to Him and weep. Why? Because that is where you're going to find rest for the soul. That is where you're going to find strength in your weakness. Because in our weakness, His strength is made perfect. Count it all joy. Don't just grit and bear it. Don't just hold on and bite onto the nails and say it'll be over soon. Learn how to have joy in the midst of trouble. See, that's real patience. And we're gonna learn a little bit more as we go along. Let me give the definition here. The definition is the suffering of afflictions, pain, toil, calamity, provocation. By the way, that's when somebody provokes you. Sometimes God uses people to help us be patient. That's probably my biggest struggle. Issues and problems are hard enough, but when people get stupid, that makes it really tough. Okay? But provocation or other evil. Now watch. Learning to suffer these things with calm, unruffled temper, endurance without murmuring or fretfulness. That is the definition of patience. Through the inspiration of God, we just read there as James captured that meaning in the whole essence when he said, count it all, everything, count it all, joy. He used that word patience there in James when it says, knowing that the working of your faith, the trying of your faith worketh patience. That word patience in the Greek is, let me see if I can say it right. Not going to get it out. Here it is. Hupomone. Okay? No. Hupomone. Hupomone. That word, it's a reason I don't speak Greek, okay? But that word in the Greek, basically in its essence, you will find that it uses two words to describe that one Greek word that we see in English as patience. And the two words that most accurately describe that word patience is cheerful endurance. Cheerful endurance. And yes, endurance is in there. That's holding on. That's sticking with it. Most of individuals that we would meet, that if you ask them what does patience mean, when you get down to it, they would talk about endurance, sticking it out, holding on, just not quitting until it's over and just let it pass. This, and my wife always says, and she uses that statement that she was raised with, this too shall pass. She tells me that all the time, and I don't want to hear it. But this too shall pass. And that's what we think of all the time. But most of the time, people will forget to use that first word, cheerful. Cheerful endurance. Count it all joy when you face these things. Patience is a quality of godliness. Because why? Well, very simple. Because God is patient. God is patient in a couple of ways. He's patient with sinners. Thank the Lord. He's patient with sinners. As we're told, Jesus joyfully endured the cross. He was patient. And listen, despising the shame, he counted all joy, despising the shame, that he had faced the cross. Why? Because he knew what he was doing. He knew what he was dealing with. And he endured that cross. But then beyond that, the Bible tells us that he's long-suffering to usward. What's that long-suffering mean? He's extremely patient. Long-suffering. You ever had those times when you look at your life, you look at the struggles you have, you look at how many times you failed, and you wonder, why in the world does God still put up with me? because he's long-suffering. Now, we're not to take advantage of that and to presume upon the grace and mercy of God. However, we do know that it does tell us he is long-suffering to us, we're not willing that any should perish. He is patient to sinners. Boy, how many times have people heard the gospel and heard the gospel and heard the gospel, and it's taken years and years and years of people praying for them, and they finally soften up, and then one day understand and are willing to accept, and they surrender to what God says must be done, and they receive Christ as their Savior. After years and years and years of being prayed for, their hardened heart finally softens enough to accept God's way and not their own. The Lord is patient. He's long-suffering, extremely patient with us as sinners. But he's also patient with the saints. Because we saints, listen, if you're a child of God, if you know for sure you're on your way to heaven, you've been forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ because you asked for that forgiveness, you have done it God's way, and God has given you the offered gift of salvation, and you know 100% for sure where you're headed, you are a saint. Doesn't mean you have a halo. All right? No, Miss Wanda's halo fell. We saw it the other night at the fireworks. She had one of those little glow things, and she had, you have like two of them together or whatever, had two yellow ones together, and they were all around, and it was around her neck, and we were all talking about, oh, look, Miss Wanda's halo fell, and just, you know, if it was one of my girls, I would have said the horns must have disappeared for a moment, but there's nothing to hold it up, but I'm picking, y'all, it's okay, but we are, listen, if you're a child of God, you are, by description, a saint of God. You are a saved individual. You don't have to wait for the church to give you sainthood. That's not biblical, all right? You are a saint automatically upon the moment of salvation, receiving Christ as your Savior and the forgiveness of sins. Instantly, you're a saint of God, according to God's word. Now, with that, God is patient with his saints, because as a saint, we are nothing more than a forgiven sinner. Doesn't mean that I'm any better than anybody else. I just know where I've placed my trust. I know where my forgiveness has come from, and that issue has been taken care of. I also know that when, as a child of God, I let this flesh rule, and I let this flesh take over, and I let this flesh win, I know as a saint, as a child of God, where I can go to clean up what has gotten between me and my Savior, me and my Heavenly Father. When there has become an area in my life that, as a child of God, has broken the fellowship with my Heavenly Father, I know where to go. I go to the same place that I received the ultimate forgiveness of my sin. I go to that same place, go to my Heavenly Father. I go through Christ Jesus. And even though, as a child of God, I cannot lose my salvation, I can lose my fellowship. Same thing is true even with an earthly father. Not that I ever get taken out of the Decker family. I was born a Decker. I will stay a Decker. And in that sense, as a child of Ed Decker, there's really nothing he can do about it, okay? Whether he likes it or not, I'm his child. I'm Melody Decker's child as well, okay? And so therefore, they're stuck with me. Now here's the thing. I will never lose, no matter what I do. They might want to disown me, but I will never lose the fact that I am a child of Ed and Melody Decker. But here's what can happen. Even though my earthly father cannot actually, he might try to, but he cannot actually disown me legally. Just facts are facts. I'm his kid. Even though he cannot say, "You're no longer my son, you're kicked out," I'm his son, period. That doesn't mean that our fellowship is always right. Can I do something to lose my sonship in the Decker family? No. But can I do something to put a wedge between me and my earthly father? Yes, I can. I can make it really hard for me to want to speak to him and him wanting to speak to me. I can do something that really brings a little bit of a damper in that relationship. Same thing is true spiritually. I cannot lose my salvation as a child of God, but I can damage my fellowship. That requires a repair before I can move forward in my Christian life. But as a child of God, as a saint of God, God is patient with me. And He's patient with you. If He wasn't, then after a couple of days of being saved, He'd go ahead and just take us home because He had enough of us. All right? Let's just be honest. You think about the things you just did this last week, the many times we failed Him, the many times we had the wrong kind of thoughts, many times we really just wanted to put our hands around that person, just squeeze. Okay. All those different things that go through our heads, all those thoughts and all those frustrations, and how many times did we fail to go before the Lord the way we should have? How many times we fail to read our Bible at the time? You say, well, preacher, I've read my Bible every single day. Have you ever just read your Bible and when you got done, you got nothing out of it? You just did your thing for the day, closed it up, and I've read my Bible. Come on now. Don't look all spiritual at me. All right? Y'all know what I'm talking about. We've all been there. You get in the routine of reading your Bible. You read your Bible. If you have a daily schedule, you read your schedule. I marked it off. Got it done. Okay, done for the day. I can move on now. I just had to get that out of the way. There are times where we sit down and we don't even spend the time with the Lord, the quality time that He asked of us. You realize that hurts Him just as much as when we go openly and do what we know we shouldn't do? Listen, to not do what we should do is just as bad to do things we shouldn't do. And so God, on a regular basis, our Heavenly Father, is extremely patient with us. Romans 15, 5 through 7 says, "Now the God of patience..." The God of patience, that's where it comes from, "and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to Christ Jesus, that ye may with one mind and one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wherefore receive ye one another, as Christ also received us in the glory of God." When you look at this, we understand that patience is something the child of God can understand and can experience and can have victory in their life with, because patience comes ultimately from the Heavenly Father. The God of all patience has the ability to impart into our lives a knowledge and an understanding of what patience really is and how I can live like Him in this area of patience. There is no one else that understands more of what patience is all about than the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I'm going to stop right here. Didn't even get as far as I wanted to. But we'll deal with what it means to be patient, the three things. We'll deal with that next Sunday. But I want you to understand, in building and understanding the importance of patience in our life, patience is not just gritting down and bearing it. It's being able to have joy in the midst of whatever we face. Patience is cheerful endurance. We have to endure, but we don't have to do it with misery. We need to endure, but we can do it cheerfully. We can understand what it is to have joy in everything that we face, no matter how difficult or easy it may be. Christ Himself, and I'll say this and we'll stop for tonight. Christ Himself, when facing the cross, understand He didn't go directly to the cross. He had to go to a mock trial. And through that mock trial, He had to have accusers come up and make false accusations. And they tried everything they could to make something stick. They went on a smear campaign of everything that He has ever done. They had people that were at one point crying, "Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna." And now they're up there willing to testify for a little bit of extra money against the one that they have watched do so many miracles. Some of them might have even been affected in their family by a miracle that He performed. Some of them might have followed at one point just because, man, this guy is different. There's something different about him. And at one point, they followed him. The next point, they're crying, crucify. They have these false accusers come forward. They have people standing around just can't wait to see what kind of judgment's going to be passed on him. One moment he's healing people and they're thankful. The next moment he's being brought before Pilate and everybody's wanting to jump on board and crucify him. He had to go through the mock trial and yet had to be patient. As a sheep before its shearers is dumb, yet he opened not his mouth. Great patience. Extreme temperance. To take all of that ridicule and all of those accusations and know that every bit of what he was going through was leading him to a cross so he could die for them. And he could die for us. Then 3 days later, rise again so he'd be victorious over every single bit of it. But he didn't just go to the mock trial. After that was said and done, Pilate had him scourged because he didn't want to crucify him. Pilate had him scourged, which technically, in many cases, killed people just in the scourging. It was that brutal. He had him scourged trying to appease the people. He didn't even deserve that. He was patient during all that. Then after the scourging, he's allowed to be taken by the soldiers and mocked and ridiculed, made fun of, being, oh, the king of the Jews, put a purple robe on him. And all that, and then they would go, they'd blindfold him and they'd slap him. Testify! Prophesy! Who slapped you? Making fun of him. He remained patient. You see, his patience was not to get rid of the trouble he was in. His patience was not just to endure until all this was over. No, he was patient to get to the cross. He was patient just to get to his final destination of what he was there to do in the first place. All that he went through, no one has endured and had to be as patient as the Lord. We say, boy, I'm suffering for Jesus right now. Now think of how much he suffered for us. That was patience. And all that he went through just to get to the cross. Then once he got to the cross, he still had to endure the mockery and all that that took place. And on top of it, the bearing of all of our sin. It was such a dark time that God took away all light so no one could see what was taking place. Complete darkness so nobody could see Christ finally bearing the weight of our sin. No one understands patience more than Christ. And no one understands how to be patient any more than our Heavenly Father. Which is why, if we need to learn patience, we've got to go to the right source. Got to make sure we go to the God of all patience and let patience have her perfect work. We'll look next Sunday night at the three areas, the three things that truly define what patience means in our life. Heavenly Father, again, we thank you so much for this evening. This is not an easy thing to learn. It's not really something anybody desires to have to go through, yet it should be something that we all should want to learn, something we should want to know, that we might be more like our Savior. I pray that you'd help us to, Lord, as we look at this area of patience in our life and as we're adding to our faith, Lord, teach us how to grow. Place within our hearts a desire to learn more about how to be more like Christ. Pray that you instruct us as only you can. May the Holy Spirit have the ability to prick our heart, to convict us in areas where we need to grow and learn these different traits, these different things that need to be applied into our life. Lord, I pray that you would please have your perfect way in our hearts. Teach us. Direct us as you would have us to go. in these areas. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. If you would you stand with me? Invitation is open. Maybe there's something in what we've looked at just already in dealing with patience. Maybe it's temperance. I don't know what it is. Maybe there's something else that you need to do. Whatever it is, the invitation's open. This is your time to respond. If the Lord has dealt with your heart about something, why don't you come to the altar? Why don't you come talk to Him for a few moments? Use this opportunity to deal with the Lord as He would have you to deal with Him. Invitation's open. How's your life of patience? How's your temperance? Have you worked hard at growing in the knowledge of God? What about virtue? Is that an area that we're improving in? All these things have got to be added to faith to grow in the Lord. Well, tonight, which is kind of a formality to a degree, but of course Miss Janelle has come back from being excommunicated the last year or so, but no, she is back with us. And now her letter actually never left the church, and she kind of joined by statement over there just for the moment, but she's coming back. Her letter of membership is still here, but Miss Janelle is coming to officially, by statement, rejoin Bethel Baptist Church so as to get back in gear here and be a part of things on a regular basis. And looking forward to what we're going to be able to see get started with young couples like Bryant and Janelle. And I've already got a list of things we're just going to throw on them. No, I'm picking. But we are gonna look forward to the Lord doing something with them. So Mr. Nell is coming tonight to officially rejoin up with Bethel Baptist Church by statement and be a part of this family, which I don't think she ever stopped being a part of the family, but she's officially back. And so I'm so glad to have her here. Looking forward to a good school year as well. And we'll see how it goes. If it doesn't go well, we'll just fire her. But no, I'm picking. But again, thank you all for being here. I'm not going to make you come down and stand in the front. I thought about it, but I'm going to be kind. I'm feeling very generous tonight. But y'all just be sure to go by and give you ladies give Miss Janelle a hug. You fellas can shake her hand. But just welcome her back officially to the church. And it is good to see some returning visitors with us and different folks. Again, pray for our many folks. Different ones sick. Do continue to pray for Brother Bob and Brother Wendell, and Brother David Taylor is struggling since his procedure that he had Wednesday. He's been having some issues. He's at home trying to recover, and there are many others. I probably shouldn't have started calling names, but they're just the ones that hit my mind for a moment there. But we got a few folks out of town as well. So just keep the church family in prayer, and if you hear somebody that is in need of prayer or whatever, please do share it with us and we will put them on our prayer list. Deacons, just a reminder, I do need to meet with y'all. I won't take very long. I won't hold you up very long. Trust me, I want to go home too. But we'll meet for just a few moments, if you don't mind. If y'all don't mind, deacons, no, they need to count them. Yeah, no. We'll meet in the meeting room, the conference room we have over there, the office. Let's just meet over there for a few moments, all right? Let's be dismissed. We'll get out of here, okay? Thank y'all for being in God's house. I greatly appreciate you. Brother Austin, if you don't mind, would you dismiss us in prayer, sir?